come on.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus. There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
There's no other name, come on.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
You are good. Praise you, Lord. Let's continue to worship God. Alam ko maulan sa labas. And I know that maulan din sa loob sa ilan dito. Pero okay lang. God's grace is not just for me. It's not just for Him. It's for everyone. And you're in the right place at the right time. Let your heart out. Praise and worship God. It's the best time to do that. Libre po, libre. Worship by God. Ano man nararamdaman ninyo, ilatag nyo lahat dyan. God will create miracles in your life. Let's worship the Lord.
Grace, what have you done? Murder for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong, a sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. The scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever a hope in my heart. Your sting, powers is dead as my sin. Cross has taught me to live. Mercy, my heart now sing. Day and its trouble shall come. Know that your strength is enough. Candle of grace, you died in my place, and my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know.
death, where is sting?
Death, where is your sting?
Come on, church.
Ours is dead as my sin. The cross taught me to live. Mercy, my heart now to sing. The day and its trouble shall come.
Clear.
I know that your strength is enough. Scandal of grace, died in.
God, for that grace, for that mercy. Lord, we thank you for loving us, God, and dying on the cross for us. We thank you, Lord, for being who you are in our life, God. We bless you, Lord. took my place because you loved me. And for you, it wasn't enough to save my soul, to set me free and to make me whole. You have a plan for me, a destiny for my life. Oh Lord, I didn't deserve your grace.
I worship you, Lord God. Can we just stretch our hands before the Lord this morning? Lord, that's our prayer for this morning and for the rest of our lives, to live and breathe for you. But in everything we do, Lord God, we will do it to honor you. Lord, thank you so much, God, for your grace and for your mercy that are new every morning, that we can always smell a fresh air, Lord God, is for feet. It's your grace, Lord, that we can always raise our hands, we can always believe in faith, that we can always trust in your goodness and your faithfulness in us and through us. Lord, thank you so much, God, even for gathering us this morning. It's a picture of your grace, that we can freely worship you, that no one will apprehend us when we worship you. It's your grace, Lord God. Lord, thank you so much, God. Lord, we even give our highest praise to you, Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Can we just give God our best applause this morning? Come on. Praise God tonight. All right. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Victory. All right. So, pasitayo po tayo. Huwag mo nang upo for at least 60 seconds. Can we please move around and meet new friends today? We have available seats on the right wing and the left wing. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Okay, we just want to welcome everyone to Victory. How many of you here, you like the place? It's cozy, it's a beautiful place. We just want to also thank God for this renovation. Of course, thank the management, right, for allowing us to use their newly renovated facilities. Thank you so much. And sabi ko nga last Sunday, at the rate that we're growing, no, diba? And God is faithful, no, na we fit in this place. And I believe also God will even expand and grow us as a congregation. Anyway, we're here to honor God and make disciples. That's our banner as a church. We trumpet that. That's why if you're here, no, you're not yet part of a life group or victory group, and hindi ka pa na one-to-one, ask the person who invited you this morning, ano ba yung victory group na yan? Ano ba yung one-to-one na yan? Alright? Kasi ito, nakakatulong to, no, sa growth natin in our walk with God. Sige, just want to even announce this, that ongoing po yung ating Superbook series sa Kids Church. And if you have kids here, please bring your kids sa Kids Church. Yung mga kids namin po, they're enjoying the Kids Church. And every Sunday, we're looking forward for that. We don't want them to miss out, no, what God is even showing them, even through Kids Church, and even molding them to be the person that God wants them to be. So, good morning once again. Good morning. Pwede niyo mangitian yung katabi niyo for a while? Say hi. Say hello. Okay, shake it off. Shake it off. Let's galaw-galaw naman tayo this morning. And grabe, for the past few weeks, last Sunday we started the series Proof, and I truly believe that it's really by the grace of God that we can even do great and mighty things. The Bible says in Romans, if you can flash it, before we bring back God's tithes and offering, it says here, therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is our spiritual act of worship. Now, I was reading this over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. Lord, grabe, sobrang powerful tong verse na to. Yung impression sa akin, Lord, that God, yung parang teaching me right now, whenever I bring back God's tithes and offering, it's not just the offering, but it's also the giver, those who are bringing it, that we become a living sacrifices to the Lord. The Lord, we're doing this, we're bringing back, not because you need it, but because we want to honor you and trust you in whatever needs that we have. By your grace, you would provide everything that we need. How many of you believe that? That God can provide, and by His grace and through His grace, sometimes, sabi ni Pastor Richie last Sunday, undeserved favor. Okay, we receive favor in Christ's expense. All right, so are you in faith this morning? Okay, let's be in faith this morning. Let's believe God. We have envelopes on our chairs. Be in faith in writing your prayer requests and believing God for supernatural, yung parang provision for all of us. Okay, right there, Lord, I believe in this. By your grace, Lord, I thank you, God. Man, that's the way it is. When you write your prayer request, be in faith. Write it as if it's happening already. Okay, so let's pray. If you're here for the first time, you're not obliged to give. And if you're writing a check, please write victory-Zamboanga. Okay, let's pray. Lord, thank you so much even for today. Thank you so much for even providing us a nice place today. And thank you so much, God, that you are good. And your love endures forever. Lord, accept our offering to you. Lord, even our life, Lord God, as a living sacrifice this morning. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Here am I.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to our 10:30 a.m. service. So glad to see everybody here today to this newly renovated, okay, Astoria Celebrity Hall. And just want to appreciate you for coming and joining us today. This is the second part of our series called Proof. Okay, and if you, how many of you were here last Sunday? Raise your hand. You were attended our first part of the series. We're not here, but we were downstairs last Sunday. Okay, we started this series called Proof, talking about the grace of God, and we are on our second week. So if you missed the previous message, we really encourage you to go back to it. I think this will really help you for the rest of the series. You can go to our website. Also want to let you know that starting today, okay, if you are out of town, out of the country, or if you have friends from out of the country, out of town, na gusto makita where you go to church every Sunday, pwede nyo pong panoorin sa live stream, okay? So yung mga tatlong nanonood ngayon, tatlo lang sila, no? Then we have several friends from outside of the country who's been asking, Pastor, kailan ba pwede mapanood pati praise and worship, not just the message, but you know, they want to see it. You can do it now through live stream. Okay, so check nyo na lang sa ating Facebook page. All right, we're going to continue our series, but before that, just a quick recap. last week we started from this verse, Acts 11:23, that says, when he arrived and saw the evidence of the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all of their hearts. When Barnabas visited the church in Antioch, he saw the grace of God. There was an evidence. And that's what we've been looking at since last Sunday. And we first looked at his story, how God's story, the whole Bible, reveals to us that our God is a God of grace. That he is the God of all grace who revealed himself to us in Jesus as someone full of grace and truth. And through the gospel of grace, we can experience his undeserved, unearned, unmerited favor and blessing of God. And last Sunday, we emphasized this point, how the fullness of God's grace is found in Christ alone. Okay, so today we're going to continue this series by looking at week 2, exceptional purity, which is another proof of the grace of God. And hopefully this will be a mark that will also be evident in our lives as we live by the grace of God. So if you're ready, turn your Bibles, Titus chapter 2. We're going to read verse 11 to 14. May I invite everyone to please stand in respect to the reading of God's word. Titus chapter 2. Verse 11 to 14. It says here in verse 11, all the way to verse 14, if you're reading NIV Bibles, please read out loud with me. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. While we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your grace. We thank you for your presence here. May you continue to speak and to minister to each and every one of us. Lord, that whatever misunderstanding we may have about you and about how you relate with us may be transformed, that the lies that we believe, Lord, will be replaced by the truth, and that those who will know the truth shall truly be set free, that we could be the people that you have called us to be. Lord, we commit to you this time. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may all take your seats. And today we're going to continue this series by looking at one proof of the grace of God is exceptional purity. Now, from this week and the next week, we're looking at more of how grace can be evident in the life of a person who received the grace of God. Okay, and one of the marks of that is exceptional purity. Now, when we say purity, a very good description of that would be 100%. Okay, pagka if you're going shopping and you're looking for pure natural apple juice or orange juice, tinitingnan mo yung ingredients. Okay, pag sinabing 100% pure orange juice or apple juice, alam mong walang additives, walang ibang mixture. Okay, and when we look at God today, I want us to understand that God is pure. Okay, God is pure, and another description maybe for the 100% for the purity is perfection. Okay, pag nakapass ka sa exam, 100% perfect. Okay, walang mali. And we all know in the Bible that God is perfect. In fact, He encourages us to be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. In other words, God expects purity in us as well. And of course, pag sinabing perfection, there's nothing in Him that's lacking. There's nothing in Him that needs to mature, that needs to grow. He is complete, perfect. Okay? And the Bible also has another word that we're going to try to understand more, and that word is the word holy. Okay? When you look at holiness, it's probably more understood in connection to purity as moral purity. In other words, with God, He is separated from sin. Sin cannot be found in Him. And sin would not last in His presence. Ganun siya ka-pure, ganun siya ka-holy. Okay, in fact, the angels would shout out to each other and cry out, "Holy, holy, holy." In other words, there is none like Him. He is unlike any other, set apart, pure, perfect, okay, and 100% God. Okay, everything good, We looked at this last Sunday, just, merciful, gracious, full of grace, full of truth, perfection. Okay, it's not just a collection of several characteristics that are conflicting with each other. Okay, pure, perfect, 100%. Now, even the angels who knew no sin, when they see God face to face, grabe, they have to cover their eyes. Okay, and the Bible says that they are like glowing beings because of the presence of God that's being reflected through them. So, can you imagine and picture the holiness and the perfection of God? Now, of course, when we look at holy and the grace of God, there are seemingly contradictory concepts that makes grace a little bit confusing and difficult to apply on a personal level. Some of these things that we connect with, yung law, okay? Which is an expression of God's justice, an expression of God's holiness, an expression of how God takes sin seriously. And on the other hand, we also have what our topic is, which is grace. Okay? Now, how do we understand the law in light of the scripture? And how do we understand grace at the same time? Because we can look at these concepts and somehow find it quite difficult to reconcile. I don't know if you've experienced that. There are those who go to the extreme of emphasizing the law. Total, sinabi naman ng Bible, di ba, we have to obey the law. Jesus did not come to abolish the law. And not one stroke of the letter of the law will be removed. Importante yung law. In fact, maraming law in the Bible. If you look at the Old Testament, we associate it as a book of the law, di ba? Books of Moses. And ang daming laws doon. So there are those who are on the law side. And there are others on those on the grace side. You cannot earn it, you cannot deserve it, you cannot repay it, so it's by the grace. Now, it's quite challenging when you look at it this way, that it's a versus thing. It's the law versus grace. And I've heard this with some teachings na parang, ano, the opposite of law is grace, and the opposite of grace is the law, which is, I believe, incorrect. Okay, and then when we look at this, especially in light of the New Testament, parang We border on both extremes when we try to choose between one or the other. There are those who emphasize the law. They believe in the importance of the law. Ito yung mga nag-extreme na bordering on the legalistic side. You have to follow the law. You have to obey the law. You know those kinds of people? Yung mga legalistic side, yung mga perfectionists. Yung mga kalala pa kayong ganon? Yung mga halaka mo people? Halaka. Halaka people. May mga ganun yan, no? Pag may kamali, halaka, lagot ka. Okay? But there are others also who go to the other side, not the legalistic side, but the licentious side. Na total, by grace naman eh. Cannot earn it, deserve it. Don't try to earn it. Don't try to deserve it. Don't try to repay it. And forgiven naman, past, present, and future sins. So it doesn't really matter how you live your life. Basta saved ka, sa heaven ka pa rin pupunta. Sometimes we have a struggle in understanding this. When we look at that. Now, when we talk about this, I hope we don't look at people and say, ah, siya yun, halaka people. Eh, yung ito yung kahit ano pwede na people. Di ba? I hope we look at even our own lives, because if I look at my own life, there are areas in my life where I tend to be legalistic, and mainly because of pride, because I feel I'm better than others in obeying God in this area. Pero may mga areas din tayo sa buhay natin na we tend to be on the licentious side. Okay lang yan. Forgive naman the Lord eh. Or patatawarin, repent ka na lang later. I mean, I've thought of that. Sometimes that has been my attitude as well. And until God had to correct me, that it's not an issue of law versus grace, but we need to understand law and grace. Because God is just, but God is also gracious at the same time. It's not an either or, but it's understanding the law more with grace and appreciating grace because also of the law. And I hope this is something that will be clarified today. So I hope na hindi tayo nandun sa side ng legalistic side. Those who are on the legalistic side or whatever area in your life you tend to be legalistic, I hope we get to find what does God say about grace and how do we understand the law in light of God's grace. And those of us who tend to be on the legalist, licentious side, na okay lang, kahit ano pwede na, total forgiven naman tayo by grace or saved by grace through faith. I hope we get to understand what does God say about the law and how does the law apply to me now that I've been saved by grace. If there's one thing I want us to remember today, it's this. The grace of God saves us and sanctifies us. Can you say that with me? The grace of God saves us and sanctifies us. Now, let me break that down into 2 points, 2 statements, and expand it more. The first one is this. We are saved and justified by the grace of God. Can you say that with me? We are saved and justified by the grace of God. Now, this is what Paul was trying to address in the church of Crete with Titus. Because there's a group of people in the church in Crete that are bordering on the legalistic side. That's what they call the circumcision group. You can find the reference in chapter 1 of Titus. There's those who are circulating the circumcision group. What they do is, yes, we're saved by grace, but you have to be circumcised to be saved. And there are others who added Jewish traditions. Kailangan pa rin yun. Kailangan bumalik tayo sa... So, kung hindi ka Jewish, you have to follow Jewish rules. There are those who are adding Jewish laws and law-keeping as part of salvation. And what Paul was trying to say here, of course, God saying to us, that for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, gave himself for us, in verse 14, to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. So Paul was trying to remind the church, those on this side, that it's the grace of God that brings salvation. It's a gift. It's a favor. It's unearned, unmerited, undeserved. Something that we could not repay. And God did it to us when he appeared on the cross. To live the sinless life, died for our sins on the cross to save us, to redeem us, and now we can have salvation by grace. Chapter 3 of Titus continues on saying, but when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior. So that having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. So this is Paul trying to remind the church that we do not earn our salvation. It's something that happens by the grace of God. We are saved, redeemed, justified by the grace of God. We have salvation, we have eternal life by the grace of God, not because of what we've done. Now, we all know that God is holy, right? God is so holy, 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 holy. God is pure. Sin cannot reside in Him. I'm sure you can all remember how serious sin was. If you look at the story of an angel named Lucifer, whom the Bible referred to as someone who is perfect in wisdom and beauty, and yet when sin entered in his heart, he was ejected from the Heavenly Father's house. Okay? Expelled from heaven. And heaven is a holy place. In fact, the Bible says, no one can see God. Blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they will see God. In Revelation, we have been given a picture of how nothing impure will ever enter heaven in the kingdom of God. And in the story of Lucifer, we see how serious sin was. Just one sin. Lucifer was expelled from heaven. And we know what that sin is. Pride. Now, question, who among us here have been guilty of pride? Konti lang kami. I think all of us at some point have been guilty of pride. And if God judged Lucifer and expelling him from heaven, I don't think we can be qualified to enter heaven. Now, that's just pride. Now, let's try to think of the Ten Commandments, kasi that's the big ten that we know. If we're going to have a quiz today, and a 10-item quiz, who among you here can name the Ten Commandments? Mahirap na i-name, no? How much more kung tatanungin natin isa-isa, who among us here have fulfilled the Ten Commandments? If I look at my own life, okay, first commandment, you shall have no other gods. I broke it. Guilty. You shall not make an idol. Hindi ko ginawa yon, but you shall not bow down to it. Oh, guilty. Do not use the Lord's name in vain. Guilty. Remembering the Sabbath and keeping it holy. Anong Sabbath? Guilty. Honor your father and mother. Guilty. Do not murder. Hindi ko naman ginawa yung pastor. Hatred in my heart, like what Jesus said, the same as murder. Guilty. Adultery. Guilty. Lust in your heart, same as adultery. Guilty. Stealing, pastor, piso lang naman eh, naiwan lang. Nasobra lang ng sukli, hindi ko sinauli. Guilty. Coveting your neighbor's property, donkey, servant, wife. Guilty. So I can say I'm 100% guilty. Breaking all the Ten Commandments. Now, in fairness, I want us to understand that there's a different reason why the law was given, the Ten Commandments. I think it's very obvious for us that the Ten Commandments was not given to Israel as a nation as a means to salvation. Hindi sinabi ni Lord na if you follow these Ten Commandments, you will go to heaven. God gave the Ten Commandments to prepare them for the promised land. And we're going to look at that later. But the law was given after they were saved out of Egypt. After they were delivered and rescued from Egypt. Oh, let's bring it to simpler. Let's go to the first commandment na lang. You know, when God gave the commandment to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, sabi ni God, you are free to eat from any tree in the Garden of Eden. So yun na lang, instead of 10 items, one item na lang. Sabi kay Adam and Eve, yung unang-una, you are free to eat from anything in the Garden of Eden except from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Yun lang, wag. You know, that commandment was not even given kay Adam and Eve somewhere in a desolate place and saying, okay, if you follow this rule, I'll bring you to the Garden of Eden. So even then, the command was not given as a means of salvation. Adam and Eve was placed in the Garden of Eden first before the command was given. It was relationship first with God. And of course, God wanted to make sure, because sometimes we think sobrang daming laws, nobody can fulfill it. If you're not careful with that, we think God is so bad. He gave us rules that we could not fulfill. But if you look at Genesis, okay, may forbidden tree. Pero for God to make sure, bago ka dumaan sa forbidden tree, makita mo muna yung tree of life. Because God is not setting us up to fail. God is setting us up to succeed. That's the goodness and the graciousness of God. But of course, the reality is, kahit nga one command lang, we fail. And we are reminded that we are saved and justified by the grace of God. Not by rule keeping. Not by law keeping. And praise God, that what we could not do, which is to obey the law and to follow the law, the grace of God can do. The grace of God brings us back to our relationship with Him because somebody fulfilled the law for us. Because Jesus lived a sinless life that we could not live, and now by grace we have been saved through faith. You know, I like the word justified because the Bible means you know, when you say justified, it's a legal declaration that you have been forgiven and free from guilt. And not only that, that you have been declared righteous and pure and holy. Not because of anything good that we've done, but because of the righteousness of Christ that is now in us. By grace. Kung disqualified tayo sa heaven, kung disqualified tayo to see God face to face because we're not pure in heart, God has now made us qualified. And God has placed in us, by faith in Christ, exceptional purity so that we can see God. So that we have an assured place in heaven to know God and to experience God. You know, to prove to us, in the Old Testament, there's somebody who was saved by grace. Of course, saved from the flood. During the time of Noah, it was a very wicked generation. God decided to judge the world because of His justice. And usually we read and think, wow, Noah was a righteous man. He was blameless before the people. And he was obedient. Kung hindi siya obedient, hindi niya ginawa yung ark, hindi siya na-save. So we need to be obey to be safe. But the Bible says even before all of that, before he was declared righteous, before he was declared blameless, that Noah found grace and Noah found favor with God. It's the grace of God that saves us, not law-keeping. And Jesus even made it clear in the New Testament, in the Gospel, we have there the thief on the right side of Jesus. Kung meron man taong dapat i-judge, eto na yon. And at the last minute, with no chance to repay whatsoever, with no chance to make things right, when the thief said, all of us, you know, we both of us thief on the left, we deserve. But this man committed nothing to deserve all this. And in his very simple prayer, Lord, remember me when you're in paradise. Anong sabi ni Jesus? Today, you will be with me in paradise. That's saving grace. That's God justifying a sinner, saying, from now on, you are no longer declared a sinner by the grace of God. Hindi sinabi ni Jesus, remember me with your paradise? Remember ka dyan. Naalala mo kung ilang kasalanan ginawa mo? Naalala mo ilang beses ka nang kinulong at hinuli? Diba? Or hindi sinabi ni God, ate ka muna dong, baba ka muna dyan, bigay ka muna ng, magpabaptize ka muna, bigay ka muna ng pera sa mahihirap, mag-obey ka muna kay Lord. No, it's none of that. It's Jesus saying, today you will be with me in paradise by grace through faith. We are saved by grace through faith. And justified by the grace of God. The second part of that statement is this, we are being sanctified and purified by the grace of God. We are sanctified and purified by the grace of God. So yung legalistic side, those who are on this side that you have to follow rules and obey to be saved, Paul was trying to correct, no, you cannot. So kung ang theme song mo is, I did my best, but I guess my best wasn't good enough. Okay, good news flash. Bad news is, you will never be good enough. And you can never be good enough to earn your way to heaven. But God is good enough to give you grace if you trust Him. Okay, now, those on the other side na, oh, okay naman, sige, hindi pala kailangan ng law, so puro licentious naman. And take note, the opposite of the law is not grace, the opposite of the law is lawlessness, just as the opposite of grace is disgrace. Because there are those who start, by grace naman, and they start living their own lives. And this is what also Paul was trying to address through Titus as the pastor of the church, that there are those Cretans are always dishonest, gluttons, and lazy. So sabi niya, Christians are not supposed to be like that. And this is what he went on explaining, saying, the grace of God saves us, redeems us, justifies us, but it, the grace of God also teaches us to say, what? No to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, eager to do what is good. In verse 14, He who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for Himself a people that are His very own, eager to do what is good. The grace of God saves us and justifies us, but it's also the grace of God that transforms us. Positionally, we have been declared forgiven, free of guilt, declared righteous, not because of any good thing that we've done, but because of what Jesus has done. But practically speaking, we also have to set ourselves apart for God. When the Ten Commandments was given, it was God telling the people, okay, now that I have set you free, I am the Lord your God who rescued you out of Egypt, and I'm going to bring you into the promised land. And in a name, in a time, and in a land full of nations who worship many gods. And in a time where people just worship God their own way, including offering their own child in the fire as a sacrifice. God was trying to tell them, I'm going to teach you how to live your life as a nation. Because I'm preparing something better for you. I have a great plan for you. I've set apart a promised land for you. And I'm setting you apart for my plans and my purposes. It started with our relationship. I am the Lord thy God. So rules without relationship is legalism. But at the same time, relationship, lang puro relationship, walang rules, it leads to lawlessness. It leads to rebellion. It leads to anarchy. And God was trying to say, okay, this is my law. Now, this is not saying parang, oh, sige, para mag-fail ka so that you cannot go to the promised land. No, when God gave those laws, it was to teach them. It was to help them protect what's valuable and what's important. It was for their freedom because sin will enslave you. Sin will hold you in bondage. So God is giving them these laws. Ito yung mga priorities nyo dapat. First, your relationship with God. Kaya nga, you shall have no other gods. Hindi pwede yung tulad ng iba na kahit anong God, pwede lang. No, there should have no other God. I am the God who saved you. Then don't worship any other God. Don't make any idols. Don't worship them or bow down to them. Because that's not me. You're saying, do not use the Lord's name in vain. Value mo yung relationship natin. Okay, God was trying to say, remember the Sabbath. Don't forget me in your week. Rest and enjoy the relationship that we have with each other. But he's also trying to tell them, value your relationship with one another. Because sin will destroy your relationship with others. That's why you honor your parents. So that you may live long in the land I'm going to give you. That's why you should not murder. You should not steal. You should not commit adultery. You should not covet your neighbor's goods and everything else. God was giving them these laws as a means of grace. To teach them. To instruct them. To set them apart as a people. It's like a parent trying to educate his children how to live. So that we can give greater glory and honor to the one who first loved us. Kaya nga relationship muna bago rules. Can you imagine what relationship would be like kung walang rules? Can you imagine how my wife or me would respond kung during the wedding, before we say I do's, okay, sige, now that we're married, kahit ano pwede? Kahit sino pwede pa rin? Of course not. Kaya nga may parts sa relationship na when you enter into a covenant, from now on, I am yours and you are mine. And that is what God is saying to us. When you enter into a relationship, God is saying, I am yours. I first loved you. And our appropriate response is not to repay it back, but because of a love unlike any other, then we want to love Him back. And this is love. Not that we first loved God, but God first loved us. And yung response natin, now that we've been forgiven and saved and justified, is God, I want to love you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. The best motivation for law-keeping and rule-obeying is not justice, but love. People can follow rules because of fear of judgment, but there is nothing, there's freedom when people obey because of love, because of relationship. In the Old Testament, when we look at the Ark of the Covenant, parang, wow, scary, Ark of the Covenant. You know, God is so holy. When you touch the Ark of the Covenant, tas hindi ikaw dapat yung nagbuhat na priest, patay. Ah, scary. You know, but the Ark of the Covenant is a reminder of us that God is gracious. The top of that is called the mercy seat. What's inside of that, the Ten Commandments, it's a reminder of God's grace. I'm gonna teach you how to live. In fact, yung first 10 commandments na basag, pagbaba ni Moses, nag-worship na ng idol, nagalit si Moses, binasag niya yung 10 commandments. Moses broke the 10 commandments all at one time. Pero sabi ni God, hindi, bago natin judge, let's still give him the law. Let's still teach him how to live. Merong favor ni Aaron, which is a picture of God's favor, na pinili ni God si Aaron, a reminder, pinili ko kayo as a nation to be a part of my plan. The jar of manna, which is a symbol of God's provision. They don't have to work. They just have to go out and gather what's for them. Trust God that God will provide. The Ark of the Covenant, yes, it's a reminder of the holiness of God, but it's a reminder of God's mercy and grace for all of us. Not only that, if you look at the temple, parang, wow, holy temple, grabe. Animal sacrifices, very bloody. And not only that, when the temple was dedicated, every part was holy. You can't just use anything. Dapat yung mga stones uncut. When you shape and work, dapat it could not be heard from the site where the construction is taking place. And it took great care, great effort, very expensive, set apart every detail. Very bloody, holy temple of God. When it was dedicated to the Lord, fire from God came from heaven and filled it. The glory filled the temple. So parang, wow, grabe, holy. Yes, I know at times we feel like parang ang hirap na malapitan si God, napaka-holy, napaka-pure, I'm just a sinner. But si God ganun, very bloody, dami niya animal sacrifice na ina-ask na dapat i-offer natin. But you know, I think our proper response should have been, every animal sacrifice, God, thank you Lord, it should have been me. But by your grace, somebody has taken my place. Something innocent. And of course, in the New Testament, we realize that it's someone who did not sin that took our place. Now that we've been saved, God has sanctified us. And we're being sanctified and we're being purified. Positionally, we've been declared righteous. Not because of what we've done, but because of what Jesus has done. It's by the grace of God. Now, of course, the laws cannot make us good. The law cannot make us pure. In our day and age, parang it's just a picture and a reminder for us of how impure we are. So where is the grace of God in it? The laws of God is a reminder for us that we need God to obey God. We need God to follow God. We need God because sometimes the will of God is good, pleasing, and perfect, but we don't trust Him. Just like Adam and Eve. We feel like parang something is missing. Siguro pag pinagbawal ni Lord yun, baka meron ayaw ni Lord na gusto ko naman doon. But when Adam and Eve started trusting in the serpent, started believing the lies instead of the truth, they missed it. But Jesus came full of grace and truth. And the more we trust Him, the more we believe Him by the grace of God, we are being changed and transformed. In the Old Testament, there was a man named Enoch whom the Bible calls someone who walked with God. I know that Enoch probably is not a perfect person. But the Bible says he walked with God for 365 years. In other words, he valued his relationship with God more than anything. If God moves, I move. If God stays, I'll stay. And he was walking with God. And after 365 years, the Bible says he was no more because God took him away. Na-save ba siya by law keeping? No. Save ba siya by rules? No. It's the relationship that he had with God. Of course, there was another man named Elijah who was taken up to heaven. Now, in the New Testament, we have one picture of the man, the only man who lived a sinless life. And his name is Jesus Christ. And you know what's amazing about him? He was a sinless man. He was a just man. But he was still gracious and compassionate. Merong isang woman committed to adultery that needs to be judged. And sa, by the law, kailangan i-stone. And they were asking Jesus, trying to trap him. Jesus said, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. And everybody dropped their stones and left. And si Jesus na lang mag-isa. But and there's the adulterous woman wondering, ano gagawin ni Jesus? And then Jesus looked at her and said, neither do I condemn you. Pero hindi sinabi ni Jesus na, in other words, parang you're forgiven. Hindi na kita kino-condemn, okay? Pero hindi sinabi ni Jesus, okay, balik ka na uli sa dati. He said, go and sin no more. And if you really receive the grace of God, and wow, in spite of what I've done, God is still so good to me, you want to love that kind of God. You want to serve that kind of God because there's a God who's unlike any other. And now that we've been saved by the grace of God, can you imagine Jesus who lived a sinless life, who lived by the power of the Holy Spirit, now because of what He did, when Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn from top to bottom, and the most holy place is now acceptable to us. You know what's even more amazing? Hindi lang tayo saved and justified and declared, wow, from now on, you are qualified to be in heaven. You have a place in heaven. You have eternal life where no impure person can enter. You have a reserved seat, reserved mansion in heaven. Not only that, but when the temple was destroyed, when Jesus died, there was an earthquake that split it. The promise is that the Holy Spirit of God will now live inside of us. And we become God's holy temple. Because Jesus fulfilled the law, now we can be forgiven and justified. Now we can have His Holy Spirit. And what used to be our weakness, hindi na tayo powerless over temptation. The Holy Spirit, God, the grace of God teaches us to say no. Struggle yan, temptation. Who among you struggled with sin? You know, I struggle with sin from time to time. You know what I realize why I struggle? Because I'm not resting my case. How do you rest your case? Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Pag will ni God, yes. Pagka ungodliness, evil, no. No discussion. No ka agad. I mean, Adam and Eve struggled because they were discussing with temptation. But if you learn how to say yes to God's will and no, we have the grace of God, the strength of God. We cannot do it out of our own, but praise God, His Spirit now lives inside of us. And now we become God's living temple. Now, if you're the kind of person who's on this side, yung isa, I did my best, but I guess my best is good enough. Yung iba naman, they're living by the grace of God, but I'm sure you know something is not right, di ba? Kahit may relationship ka na, if you're not living right, something is not right. Yung anak ng Secretary of Justice cannot say, oh, from now on, I can do whatever I want kasi tatay ko naman yung Secretary of Justice. That's not right. And there are people, sometimes you get condemned more and more kasi parang, I know I'm bad, I know it. Woo! Diba? Pero at least forgiven ako, at least pumunta ako sa heaven. Is that the kind of life God wants us to have, a life without freedom? Well, I want to encourage you, there's forgiveness for you because God's grace is always bigger than our sin. But it's not just for your forgiveness, but it's for your freedom. We can receive the grace of God so that we can be free to follow God and free to enjoy the fullness of what God has for us. I want to invite the music team to come up. We're going to pray. Can we just bow our heads and pray? Lord, we thank you for your goodness and grace. How you lived a sinless life and yet died like the worst of sinners so that the worst of sinners like me can be saved and justified by grace through faith. So that sinners in bondage and in slavery to sin, by your grace, can be sanctified and purified. That we are not just sinless positionally because of what you've done and we have a place secure in heaven, but that we will also live our lives practically and that we would sin less and less and less as you teach us to say no to ungodliness. As you teach us how to live our lives for your glory and for your honor. As you are restoring your image and likeness in us, Lord, we set ourselves apart for your plans and for your purposes. Can we just all stand? I just want to pray for two groups of people. If you're here today and you're still burdened by guilt and shame and condemnation, I'm going to pray for the grace of God to set you free. For the grace of God to be upon you so that you'll know that you've been forgiven. But I also want to pray if you've been struggling with sin, it's like an on and off thing with God. I'm going to pray for freedom and power to say no. So if that's you need any of those prayers, can you just lift up your hands as we commit this time to the Lord and surrender ourselves to God. That's you. Just lift it up. You need prayers in any of this area. Lord, we pray, God, for the grace of God. Lord, we know, God, that we could not earn it. We know, God, that we could not deserve it. We could not even repay it. But Lord, we thank you, God, that the fullness of grace in Christ can be ours by faith. And we can receive one blessing after another. Lord, we cry out for your mercy. We cry out for your forgiveness. And right now, Lord, as we surrender to you these sins, this guilt, this shame and condemnation, Lord, we ask for your grace that saves us and justifies us, Lord. And let there be assurance, Lord God, that we've been forgiven, that we've been declared righteous, not because of what we've done, but because of what you've done. But Lord, I also pray, God, for those who are struggling with a particular type of sin, Lord, or temptation, Lord God. I pray, Lord, for your power to set us free, to break us free, Lord. That we don't have to live like this anymore. That we can live for your glory and for your glory alone. Not by our own efforts, not by willpower, Lord, but by the power of your grace that's so at work in us, Lord God. It transforms us from deep within. Can we just worship the Lord? Let this be our prayer. Let this be our desire. Thank you. Allow the Spirit of God to minister to you.
Didn't deserve your grace. I didn't deserve your mercy. But still you took my place. Because you love me. And for you, it wasn't enough to save my soul. To set me free and to make me whole. You have a plan for me. A destiny for my life. So I live to give you glory, and I breathe to give you praise. You paid the ransom for me, and you took away my shame. You said that you delight in me, and I know your word is true. Receive your grace. Now I receive your grace. I receive your mercy. I want to be like you, to follow your heart. For me, it wasn't enough to take your name, accept your gift and remain the same.
My life is not my own. So come. September 14th at UC Auditorium. September 14th at UC Auditorium. And then, this coming Sunday, dito tayo sa Sunday. Alright? So, just close in prayer. Lord, thank you so much, God, even for this day. Thank you so much that your grace is sufficient. Your grace will lead us to say no more. So, Lord, I pray that we as we go up to this place, that we will appreciate your more, Lord God, of your goodness, of your faithfulness, and what you gave 1,000 years ago. And we will go up from this place blessed, and you are celebrating your love for each and every one of us. Thank you so much for you today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless everyone. We invite your friends next week. Let's be praying with this person. Thank you.